1968. John Carlos is my name. Track and field used to be my game. We felt in 1968 as young athletes that we had some very serious issues that we needed to deal with in society that has been swept under the carpet for so many years. We felt that we had ample opportunity over the time to achieve a better standard of life for all people. We looked for the presidents to do it. We looked for big business to do it. We looked for clergy to do it. We looked for just good, right adults to take care of the issues, to try and make this a better society. We felt that they didn't step up to the plate. There's no one man can do it. It has to be collective interest to change society. So we came up with this idea that we can change things through the Olympic movement, through athletics. We young individuals got together, we formulated a program called the Olympic Project for Human Rights. That was our charter, to have the attention focus on the human element and how we live and how we live amongst one another and how we treat one another. We tried to organize an Olympic boycott to bring attention to society that there's a problem and we must deal with this problem. By requesting individuals to sacrifice, you know, their game or their 15 minutes in the sun after working all their lives to achieve the Olympic plight or the Olympic berth. Many individuals felt like that was very difficult for them to sacrifice all that time to give it up just for the sake of boycotting the Olympic Games. We tried to educate them as to why we felt it was necessary to do this boycott. Many of them were still not ready to sacrifice that. Then we decided that, okay, we'll take a vote. We took a vote. They decided that we want to go to the Games. Right at that instant, the boycott was null and void. But I felt when I went to the Olympic Games that I was disenchanted for the fact that the boycott was called off. I confronted Mr. Smith about it. He agreed with me that something needs to be done. We got together to make a statement that we felt would be nonviolent, but yet still potent enough to send shockwaves through our society, to resurrect people's conscience that had gone dormant, had gone to sleep, or just dissipated altogether, to have them become aware that you still have the responsibility to be concerned about your neighbor. You still have a responsibility to be concerned about people in other countries. You still have a responsibility to be concerned about society in general. This Olympic demonstration reached throughout the world, but at the same time it reached throughout the world, many people in the right-wing press decided it was a threat towards them. So they decided they would put a spin on it and make it like it was a black militant activity taking place. They just kicked the fact that we had the project for Olympic Project for Human Rights. They kicked that up under the carpet as they kicked everything else that was for righteous, for good. They just tried to bury it. And in time, God, you know, revealed that demonstration one more time and made it aware throughout the world that this demonstration was not a militant act, this demonstration was a humanitarian act. And through that, I think many, if not all, ethnic groups throughout the world can touch that relation, that demonstration, and say, I have a relationship with that demonstration because we've had tyranny, we've had to deal with prejudice, we had to deal with virus, we had to deal with death and destruction. So it became full circle in terms of why we did it, where we did it. Where we did it at the Olympic Games, we felt that that was the most effective place to do it, where we could put it on a world level for people in the world to have an opportunity for themselves to digest and figure out for themselves whether this is something that they should stand up for to make it a better world, not for themselves, but for their kids and their kids' kids and those that might come after them. Yes, I think it had tremendous impact on tackling racism for the first time. I think it was put on front street, so to speak, for society to deal with racism on a universal level. I think those individuals that was perpetrating racism was out there. They pulled the the drapes down. They not, could not be racist behind doors anymore. They were out front. They had to come out front to be racist. Based on the way that they treated Mr. Smith and Mr. Carlos, based on the way Australia treated Mr. Norman as a result of the three of us being in that victory stand, they revealed to the world how racist they were just merely because of the way they treated us. Well, I've been doing pretty much the same thing that I did in Mexico City, standing up for, you know, not just merely social justice, but for a justice and equality on a full-scale basis. I don't look at it in terms of social justice or black versus white. I look at it right versus wrong, as simple as that. I don't care what your ethnic background is. I don't care how much money you have. I don't care if you're fat, skinny, good-looking, ugly, tall, skinny, short. It doesn't matter. What does matter is whether you're right about what you're doing or whether you can have a foundation to secure the fact that you're right. But if you're wrong and you don't have no foundation to back up or support the fact that you're wrong, you're just wrong, but you want to run it because you feel you're the power broker. Well, I'm here to let you know that there's forces such as myself that stand against you being wrong. It's my attitude about having things right and pure for our kids in the future. That's what I stand for today. Well, I think Barack Obama is a gallant individual. First of all, to come into the presidency at one of his most critical times in world history, not just the history of the United States. I think that Mr. Obama is going through a period of time such as Jackie Robinson went through, to be the first to cross the color line in baseball, to be the first to cross the color line at the highest level of politics. And still, both of them have a parallel when it comes to racist attitude or bigotry towards what they have accomplished. There's no president in the history of the presidency in the United States that had to endure what Mr. Barack Obama had to endure relative to his religious vows, relative to his sexual preference, relative to the mere fact that he chose to expound upon, you know, sexual preference. They say that, oh, he's anti this, he's anti that. He says that I'm not God, and anybody that thinks that they're God relative to that have to second guess themselves and go back and research this in their minds again. So many people are disenchanted about that. The mere fact that they question the man about it as to whether he's a citizen of the nation to run for highest order, when they go and prove the fact that he is a citizen, he had a birth certificate, they're still running that today in the state of Arizona, to the point where they come back talking about, well, we're going to take his name off the ballot because we don't think that he's a citizen of the nation of America. This is erroneous. The fact that the Republicans don't give a hoot about any laws that he tried to pass, and anything he tries to do for the general public, they denounce it and try and pull him down. And then there's even still somewhat division within the Democratic Party relative to whether they're backing this man 100% to achieve the goals that he's attempting to achieve. And I would hope that the American people on both sides of the street would take into account. Now, I don't care what your ethnic background is going to the White House. It's going to take you 4 years to make the adjustment. You can't judge an individual in the first 4 years. You can only judge him on the second. Now, Mr. Bush was there for 8 years. They let him ride for 8 years. They never denounced any of the things that he was doing, but they feel the tyranny based on what he did, not just in the United States, but around the world. So if they can give Mr. Bush 8 years to do what he did, they can sure give Mr. Obama the 8 years to get us out of the situation we're in now. My heroes, first of all, my first number one hero is my dad and my mom. They're the forerunners and heroes of my life. In terms of the way they raised their kids, the love that they gave to their kids, the values, the morals, the visions that they gave their kids. So I would have to put them first. But outside of them, you know, I can go down the line. There's a number of heroes that I have. Paul Robeson is the number one hero in terms of what he did so long ago and had so much to offer to society, but had his views in terms of, I have to be a left winger just based on the fact that, hey, what they're doing is wrong and no one is stepping up against it. So it made him a left winger because he challenged the right wing system. So I admire and respect him for that. Jackie Robinson, I admire Jackie for crossing the color line and enduring it the way he did. and still having the stamina to stand up for justice and equality. Even though he had to go through all the changes, he didn't come off in terms of being a bitter individual. He came off in being a stern and wise individual. Rosa Parks, for Rosa Parks being the woman that kicked off the civil rights movement, in my eyes and estimation, she's the modern day Harriet Tubman. She didn't take him to the Underground Railroad. She made the railroad possibly be above ground. Adam Clayton Powell, Malcolm X, Martin Luther King, Gandhi, Nelson Mandela, all these individuals are dear to me in my heart and always be there. And there's many more that was there before them. But these are the ones that's most current to me. You know, I revere all of them. And when people try and put me in the league with them, I smile at them and tell them, I say, I appreciate the thoughtfulness that you would think that I'm with them. But no, I'm not quite there yet. These individuals are true, true heroes to me. Well, I think we could do a better job relative to the sports personalities of today. I don't think that they take into account that they're a vehicle to educate many young minds, you know, to push them to school to study. If they don't want to elaborate on, you know, their history, like expounding that to a youngster, they can encourage a youngster to go and find out on their own, to research on their own. I think they can do a far better job in terms of expressing to kids about the importance of education, the importance of finding out who the man is in the mirror or who the woman is in the mirror, the importance to realize what drugs have done in the past and what continues to do. It's important for them to set a frame or to be a model for kids. And they have to take into account, you know, a lot of young athletes right now today say, well, you know, I didn't want to be their role model. It's not their choice as to whether they want to be a kid's role model. The mere fact that you out there as a superstar, the kids dictate pretty much as to who they choose to be their role models and so forth. You just have to keep that in mind and try and conduct yourself in a very professional manner, and a very, very manly or very womanly manner in terms of going for the right direction, in terms of, opposed to getting in trouble, opposed to doing sinister things, opposed to being in the press in a negative sense by doing foolish things, that giving kids the impression that it's okay because my hero did this. Well, I think the first message that I would give kids, what I spoke with earlier, in regards to young kids getting in touch with the man and the woman in the mirror, find out who you are. You can't find out anything about your history until you fully understand who you are. And once you understand who you are, then you have a means to delve into your history and find out who you truly are from your roots. And when you see things that was wrong, you can make them right. When you see things that's a little fuzzy, you can clear them up. You can't challenge anything that you don't know anything about. This Show Racism the Red Card. Well, I think that's a very powerful organization to let people know that racism is very harmful, very sick. It's a disease. It's something that needs to be stomped out, wiped out, put out, stopped. For those individuals that think they can be racist like they were back in the 40s and the 30s and the 20s, this is 2000, and we're going into the new millennium and a lot smarter attitude. We're no longer sitting back on our hands, letting you and allowing you to be racist and biased and upset the whole apple cart. And that goes for owners as well as players. So I applaud the Red Card, and I would hope that they will continue, and I would hope that they grow. I'm all the way with you, Red Card.